Welcome back to my channel, everybody. Today I'm here with my worst books that I read in 2021. The first book that I have is Five Total Strangers by Natalie D. Richards. This book was just really predictable to me, and not only that, because even if a book is predictable, I feel like it can still have some substantial, I don't know, part of it. But it just was boring, and every single mini twist even was predictable, and you knew exactly what was going to happen, and the writing was dull and boring, and it just went on and on and dragged on forever, it felt like. And this is a relatively short read, and I still felt like it just went on forever and like nothing substantial happened really that you didn't fully expect, and I just didn't like it. I felt like it was relatively unbelievable, and I'm just not a fan at all. So this one I ended up giving, I think, 2 stars. Then I have Playing with Fire by April Henry, and this one I did give 1 star. This was one that was actually on my most anticipated Goodreads shelf for 2021, and I ended up, you know, as I said, hating it pretty much. It's kind of a survival story about this these two people that go on a hike in Oregon, and they end up, there's like fires everywhere, and they kind of get stuck, and they end up, you know, getting together with this group of people who are also stuck, and it's just so formulaic. And there's just this pattern where they would be trying to escape because they're hiking and there's this like fire going on, and they would hike for like a couple pages and then something bad would happen, they'd fix it. They'd hike for a couple pages, something bad would happen, they'd fix it. And then honestly, they just randomly get rescued, and that's like the end of the book. It was very unbelievable, very badly written. It's a very short story. It's under 250 pages. So for a novel, it's pretty short, and it still just didn't deliver what needed to be delivered. I thought that it was really bad, and I wouldn't recommend it at all. Then I have The Mall by Megan McCafferty, and this one I give 2 stars. It wasn't the worst thing that I read all year, but it just wasn't good. It's set in the 90s about this girl who like gets a job at a mall, and it's set in the 90s, but even though it was released in 2020, it is written like a 90s, early 2000s YA contemporary. Like those old books, like I can't even think of any, but like I want to say like Sarah Dessen and stuff, like those early 2000s, like late 90s kind of titles. It was written like that, like so over the top, so cheesy. Just the character, even though she's in high school, she just felt so immature, like almost like elementary level sort of dialogue and discussion and like thought. And it was just not for me. It was not good at all. This really should be marketed, honestly, as like a middle grade book with the way that it's written and just like the lack of development or plot in character and plot. I just didn't like it at all, and I wouldn't recommend. I mean, I wouldn't recommend any of these, but yeah, it was not good. Then I have The Dark Tide by Alicia Jasinska, and this one I also gave 1 star. This is another one that was on my most anticipated list. It's just one of the worst books I read this year. It sounded like everything that I would want in a book. It was about witches, and it's sapphic, and it's like a small island coastal town, which I love. Those are just the vibes that I really like Wicked Deep, like a coastal sort of witchy vibe. I just am a huge sucker for, but there's so many plot holes. There were so many just like developments that didn't make sense. And I would even go back in the audiobook and listen to it again, and it still wouldn't make sense. So I know I wasn't missing anything. The dots just weren't connecting. So huge plot holes. There was no history, which I feel like would have been a really nice thing to have with a, if I'm not like croaking to death, which would have been a really nice thing to have, I feel like, with, oh my God, am I okay? I feel like I'm dying. This is a magic system, a fantasy book, and there was no history. There was no why. You know, it's about this witch who comes to this island town and like steals someone away every year, every couple years or something. And there's no background. There's no information about the magic system. There's no info about like where the witches came from. There's no info about where this tradition started. It would have been really cool maybe to get a small flashback to like the first time it happened. There's no explanation like why or what will happen if they don't. It said that like the water will start rising, but like why? Like it just doesn't, nothing was really making sense. This book also has a really bad case of insta love. Like they meet like once and they're like crazy in love, and just super unbelievable romance. You're not rooting for them, you're not connecting with them, it makes it hard to like care. And then the last thing I would say that I am remembering that I really, really didn't like is that her, the main character, not the witch, the other one, the main character, the girl from the island, her older brother is super abusive, like just insanely, insanely abusive, physically, emotionally, mentally abusive. And it's really just kind of brushed over. Like, just kind of like, oh, we're gonna throw in this really bad thing, but we're not going to challenge it or discuss it at any sort of length or level. And it's like, what's the point then? You're just making us read abuse, like sibling abuse for no reason. And it's not being like challenged. So I felt like that was really, really shitty. I hate it when any book does that, when they put in this really terrible, traumatic thing that a lot of readers personally go through, and then it's just kind of like whatever. Because it makes it seem like it's just not a big deal when it's a huge deal. So, did not like that. Then I have kind of a random one, but I have Yakuza Lover Volume 1 by Nozomi Mino. And I have been really trying to expand my reading horizons. So I've been, you know, in 2021 in particular, I picked up a lot of books that I wouldn't normally pick up. And I think maybe that's why I had a less successful reading year. I read a lot more this past year, almost double as much as I read in 2020. But my average rating was super, super, super down. So I think I was really trying to expand my reading horizons and read a lot of different, you know, I read a lot of nonfiction, I read a lot of memoir, which I'm normally not a fan of, I read some poetry, I really tried to get into manga, I read more graphic novels, like, I tried to explore avenues that I wouldn't normally gravitate towards, just to kind of see how I would like them, and I feel like I did learn a lot about myself as a reader and things that I like and don't like in literature. But one of the things that I really wanted to get into was manga. And I had a couple like kind of smutty romance manga on my want to read shelf on Goodreads. And so when I saw Yakuza Lover on NetGalley, I decided to pick it up for the Asian Readathon. Because I thought, you know, it's a genre I want to read from. It's on NetGalley. It was like a read now too. And it would cover one of the challenges for the Asian Readathon. So I decided to pick it up just as kind of like an intro to the like romance manga genre. And I hated it. I did not like this book at all. I'm not like completely cutting off romance manga now because of this. I think this was just a story that I really didn't like. But I see this everywhere. Like I see it at my local like Barnes & Noble a lot. It's like, it was actually one of the books that was like turned out to be like front facing on the shelf. So I was like, oh, they normally only do that with like relatively popular titles. And then I see it on Goodreads, it pops up a lot. And the new one just came out, so I saw that on NetGalley and Goodreads a couple times. Volume 3, I believe, just came out. So like I see this a lot. So I think, like, I thought maybe this was just kind of more of a like not as popular title, so maybe it like isn't as good, or maybe it's a newer creator. But this seems to be relatively popular, so I'm definitely gonna pick up more romance manga, but let me know if this is kind of how they all are, if you've read Yakuza Lover, because I did not like this. So if this is how they are and this is like kind of the norm, give me a heads up. But I want to try other creators, I want to try other authors and see kind of how the romance manga genre works for me. But this one seems to be relatively popular, which is kind of the opposite of what I thought while I like was reading it. So we'll have to see. But I thought there was like no plot, there was no character development, and I get that it's a manga, so like you have to keep reading, but like even considering that, it's only like, considering that, it's like nothing happened and no character development. And the writing style art style I wasn't a huge fan of either, because it's like sometimes they would be drawn in a realistic fashion and sometimes they would be drawn in like this kind of like like bubbly, almost like cartoon fashion, which I don't mind, like, you know, if you switch it up every now and then, or that's just if it maybe adds something to the like what's going on in the current moment. But what I didn't like is that there were like certain panels where the guy would be drawn realistic and the woman would be like pressed up against him in like a cartoon fashion. And I just felt like it was really childish and kind of almost like gave off really creepy vibes, because he is drawn like a man and she is drawn to look more like a child. And I just didn't like that at all. I felt like it was really uncomfortable. And I don't know. I know that that's like relatively common, I feel like, in manga, and I've seen it before, but in a romance manga like this, where they were like pushed up against each other and whatnot, it just made me a little uncomfortable. So I would not recommend this one, but also I'm not super familiar with romance manga, so you guys will have to let me know if that's kind of like the norm, or if I just maybe picked up like a not as good one for my first read. So we'll see. Then I have Out Now, Queer We Go Again, which is a queer anthology collection. I was trying to read this for, I'm not even kidding, years. I got approved for this on NetGalley in 2020, tried to pick up a couple stories and did, couldn't get into it, like waited until 2021, tried to read it a couple more times, couldn't get into it. Like this was the worst anthology I've ever read. I thought that all of the stories really felt the same. It was the same story kind of over and over again with maybe a different theme or something thrown in. Or maybe some of them would be kind of sci-fi or something, or fantasy, and that's it. They were really just formulaic stories, just boring, formulaic, predictable stories, where a lot of them I just didn't connect with the characters whatsoever. And I felt like as a collection, like as a whole, it just wasn't strong. It wasn't a strong collection. It didn't, you know, the stories didn't kind of, I don't want to say bounce off each other, because that doesn't need to happen in an anthology, but they weren't different enough to make the anthology really feel worthwhile. Not only that, but I didn't like the representation. It was mainly L and G, and we were missing the BTQIA+ of it all. So it was really, I feel like, not a good representation of the queer community. And it was super disappointing to me. Also, I did want to add as well, because I was just flipping through my review to make sure that I didn't miss anything, because I read this so long ago and have pushed it out of my mind. And there was a story that I did not read in here by Meredith Russo. This author has since come out as a domestic abuser, and that actually came out, I say since, but it actually came out before they even published the title, as far as I know, and in my research. So, you know, something else that I really didn't like about this is the fact that they took this information, this woman coming forward saying that this person, you know, abused them, and they still published an anthology with a story by this author. So I thought that was really sketchy. I thought it was really iffy. And even if I'm incorrect and they did publish it afterwards, you would think that would be something maybe that would be addressed, but it wasn't. It's never been addressed according to reviews and articles that I have looked up personally. And yeah, so that is something else I remember being kind of thrown off about, because I just felt like it was really inappropriate and just really sad, to be honest. So I did not like that at all. Then I have Murder, a graphic memoir of a true crime obsession by Hillary Fitzgerald Campbell. I gave this 1 star. It's one of the worst things I've read all year. This is a graphic novel about a woman who just discusses her journey and falling in love with true crime, and that's fine. You know what I mean? Like, I even said in my review of this that's fine. Like, if you love true crime, if you like, you know, true crime stories, and you get into the podcast and, you know, books and TV shows and movies, like, that's completely fine. It's super popular right now, actually, so it's like more than fine, because like Netflix even is coming out with like all these things about like true crime stories and podcasts. It's like, I swear true crime podcasts are always like number one on like Spotify and iTunes and whatnot. Apple Music, right? iTunes? Is that even a thing anymore? Whatever. So anyways, that, like, obviously, as I said in my review, I'm not trying to bash anybody who likes true crime. That's one thing. Like, I'm not bashing anybody for having that sort of passion or that sort of interest. The problem stems from the fact that she really almost like fetishizes and is like obsessed, just like she says, obsessed with true crime. And she talks in the book a little bit about like, oh, I don't want to romanticize these murderers and not pay tribute to these victims. And then that's exactly what she does. She discusses like Ted Bundy at length and doesn't really honor or respect the victims or express how bad of a person he was. She just goes on these like rants and these obsessions without ever like saying this was wrong. It was just icky. It felt gross. It felt like she was being like a fandom or one of those people who are like, oh, like, you know, so attractive, like all those weirdos that are like obsessed with serial killers. That's what this gave off, and I think it's disgusting. Also, the art style was so bad. Oh my it's barely like legible, honestly, the way that this was drawn out as a graphic novel. I've taken a lot of classes actually when I was in uni on graphic novels and comics and panel design, and it's not, I can tell you straight up, there was no purpose to this panel design. It does not add anything to the story. It does not benefit the story or have any sort of underlying meaning at all. It is just a mess. And I just hated this book so much. I think it's toxic. I think it's bad. And I don't think that it should have been published, to be honest. Then I have a sequel, which I think is the only sequel I read actually in all of 2021, to be honest. But that is Our Dark Duet, Monsters of Verity number 2 by Victoria Schwab. I was really just kind of like, I couldn't tell what I was in the mood for, and I was like really trying, I've been really trying to like cut down my TBR on Goodreads and read books that have been on my, you know, my TBR for a really long time. And I couldn't decide what I was in the mood for, and so I just put on Our Savage Song, or The Savage Song. And I ended up really enjoying it, like a lot more than I thought that I would, especially because it's like a fantasy monster type story, and it's YA, and it's older, and it's just a lot of things that I didn't think that I would enjoy. But I ended up really, really enjoying it, oddly enough. So I instantly, because it was available at the library, I instantly picked up Our Dark Duet, because it's a duology, and I was so invested into the story, and I was so in love with the story that I still wanted to be in the world, and I just wanted to like finish the duology. So I picked up Our Dark Duet right after, same day actually, that I finished The Savage Song. I just wanted to jump right into it. And this was such a disappointment. I felt like nothing happened. I felt like the characters that we knew from The Savage Song weren't the same characters that were in Our Dark Duet. They felt so different, and I get that there was, you know, time was supposed to pass in between the two books, and I get that the characters change, and I get that there's development, and it's a series, so like obviously over time they're going to be different people, but they were so different and so random, and there were no hints even of the characters they used to be, in my opinion, and I just didn't like it. I know I've said that for all of these. I just didn't like it. But I didn't. This one was just boring and flat, and I feel like she was just writing this to like hurry up and like get the duology over with. That's genuinely what it felt like, that this was just written really quick, really fast, not a ton of thought into the world building and development of this as a series, and she just wrote this book to try to like kind of get over it. That's my thought. I genuinely was going to DNF this, but I, because it's only a duology, I was like, I need to stick with it so I can just finish the duology and just have it be over with. And I'm glad that I did, because now I can, you know, have like an opinion on how I feel about it as a whole. But I also kind of wish that I didn't, because it was so bad that it didn't affect me at all. So that's that one. Then I have Every Day by David Levithan. And this is one of the ones that I read for that TBR Veterans video that I was really disappointed in. And I actually own this book, but I don't feel like getting it. I loved the first half of this book. I was really in love with the writing style. I fell in love with the characters, Rhiannon specifically. And I love the concept, the idea, the execution, everything about this I really, really loved. I own this book, and like the first half is like annotated and highlighted like up to the heavens, like so much, almost every page, I'm not even kidding, has some sort of annotation. And then like about at the halfway point, it just loses me. Our main character A feels insta-love for Rhiannon, and she's not really giving that back to him. This is a really old book, so I'm kind of saying some spoilers, I guess, but this book came out in like 2014 or something, so I don't know what to tell you. But you know, it felt some type of way, and she's not really giving that back to him, and so then he just like, each time he gets into a new body, this is also a movie actually, which I want to watch, but anyways, each time he goes into a new body, he still somehow finds a way to like go stalk Rhiannon. It's just super creepy. I don't like it at all. I also felt like there were some really transphobic remarks actually in this story. There was like a time where A gets put into a trans body, and Rhiannon is like saying some really like terrible things, and it just was really random to me, because A, why is that in a book at all? Like, gross. And B, we're supposed to like love her. We're supposed to love this character, and then she just goes and does something like that. It just seems so random. Not to mention that at the beginning, she is seen as just this really like laid back, really cool, really chill, like kind of this perfect, you know, like pixie manic dream girl, to be honest. And then she just completely, her character just kind of switches like that. So I found that really random. Overall, I just feel like it was really problematic. I loved the first half, but the latter half made it so bad that I gave it 1 star because I just felt like it was so... The book switched up so much and it just became so toxic. So do not recommend this. It's a really old book, so I don't imagine a lot of people are picking it up anyways right now, but don't go back to it. And then the last book that I have is The Photographer by Mary Dixie Carter, which I actually have a whole dedicated reading blog for when I was doing my Thrill Seeker series, which I'm going to continue in 2022 for sure. But it's where I do a dedicated reading blog with full spoilers and predictions and everything for thriller novels, and we try to like seek out the best thrillers. But I've only done one like episode, if you will, and it was a terrible book. And I even say in that video so many times like how bad I feel that this book is the first one that I'm doing for this like new series, and it ended up being a 1 star. I have like an hour long reading blog for this, so I'm not gonna go into it too much. I just couldn't connect to like the main character. I couldn't connect to the side characters. I had no sympathy for like any of the characters, honestly. And that's kind of hard because in a thriller, it's like you wanna be like rooting for somebody or not rooting for somebody, but I wasn't rooting for everybody, so it made it just like really complicated and weird, and it wasn't thrilling at all. There were no twists, nothing really happened except on the literal last page, which is so predictable too, and the writing was just super stilted, honestly. It was just I don't even want to think about that book. So those are all the worst books that I read in 2021. So I hope that you guys enjoyed this video. Be sure to leave a comment letting me know the worst book or books that you read in 2021, and maybe why, so I can like stay away from them since I'm trying to have a better reading year this year. I will see you guys in the next video. Bye!